One of these three women had her baby stolen from her. Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Alma Sipple.
Number two.
My name is Alma Sipple.
Number three.
My name is Alma Sipple.
Only one of these people is the real Alma Sipple, and is the only one sworn to tell the truth. Now let's meet our panel, actor and raconteur Orson Bean. The Emmy Award-winning co-star of Golden Girls, Betty White. Film and television producer David Niven Jr. And temporarily unable to make her usual grand entrance, our very own Kitty Carlisle. Here's the host of To Tell the Truth, Lynn Swann.
How's everyone today? This is so good. Everyone looks wonderful. Betty, I love that color on you.
Oh, thank you. Which one? The blue or the green?
Yes,
the black,
I love that blue.
Oh, thank you.
No, maybe you could lend it to him after the show.
Yeah.
You can have it during if you wish.
The colors on my side are nice, too.
Speaking of color, look at that.
Absolutely gorgeous. You know, thank you. Is that see-through?
Well, I hope not.
No, no. No, it's not. I'm only teasing, Kitty. But it's absolutely adorable. And guys, you look pretty good, too.
Oh, thank bless you, man.
Thank you.
Throw it to you guys. You guys are okay. All right, let's get right to the story presented by our first team of challengers, all three of whom claim to be Alma Sipple. And here is her story. Please, read along with me. I, Alma Sipple, had my daughter stolen from me 44 years ago. I was a young mother, naive, broke, and living in a one-room apartment with my infant daughter, Irma. A social worker named Georgia Tan noticed Irma's runny nose and generously offered to have her checked out at the hospital. A few days later, I was devastated when Tan told me my baby had died. But what really happened was Tan had sold Irma as a black market baby. And it wasn't only Irma. Tan sold over 5,000 other children. Recently, the television program Unsolved Mysteries told the story of an infamous social worker who made millions running a baby adoption ring. When I saw her picture on television, I screamed. It was the same woman who'd stolen Irma. Through the show, I was put in touch with an agency that specializes in reuniting families separated by adoption. And last week, I saw my Irma again for the first time in 44 years, signed Alma Sipple. We'll find out more about this black market baby ring right after this. Welcome back to Tell the Truth. Panel, all three of these people claim to be Alma Sipple, who found her stolen child after 44 years. Kitty, let's start with you.
Wonderful story. Number one, where had Irma lived all those years?
Irma lived in Cincinnati.
And number two, where did you live?
I lived in California most of the time.
You were far apart from each other.
Yes,
ma'am. And number three, whatever happened to the infamous baby seller?
Well, Georgia Tan was convicted.
And did she go to jail?
She wasn't convicted. She was charged, but she died just before the charges came up.
I see. Number one, do you live near Irma now? Are you all together again?
No, we're quite separated. She still lives in Cincinnati. And I live in Boston.
And number two.
Kitty, thank you. David.
Thank you. Number one, what was the name of the agency and where was it that you went to?
It was an adoptive agency in Boston. And Georgia came there, came from there, I should say. And she was investigating somebody in my apartment building at the time. It was during the war, 1946.
All right, thank you. Number two, when you were first reunited with your daughter, what was her reaction and what was yours?
Well, after 44 years, you can imagine. I hope you can imagine anyway.
Let's move down the line to Betty White.
Number three, you were told your baby died. When did you find out your baby had not died?
Not until I saw the program on TV.
number one, you recognize the woman, but even at the point that you recognize that woman, you must have known that she was not all she was cracked up to be, not just a social worker.
At the time, she had all the correct papers when she took my child. I gave her my child because she was ill at the time, and I was without funds.
Thank you. You'll never know who I was going to ask next.
Number two, Alma Sipple, number two. Alma Sipple, I just like to say Alma Sipple. I mean, there's some names. Alma, I hope we get to meet Irma Sipple. Irma and Alma Sipple. There's some names. Ricardo Sipple Montalban, too. I like to say that, too. Now, Alma Sipple, number two. Now, did you have a wonderful reconciliation with your daughter? It must have been a tremendous shock for both of you.
Yes.
Yeah?
Absolutely.
Number three, how did it work out when you met? Have you established a relationship?
Oh, yes. Very definitely.
Number one, have you forgiven, what's her name, the infamous Georgia Tan in your heart? I guess I'd be, well, I'm sure
no,
the devil has
her
listening to eternal accordion music right now. number two.
Thank you, Orson. That means the time is up. Time for you to vote for either number one, number two, or number three. Our team of challengers will receive $500 for each incorrect vote, with a guarantee of $1,000, and if the panel is fooled completely, the team will receive $3,000. So, panel, if you're ready to cast your ballots, Kitty, we'll start with you.
It's a bittersweet story, but it does have a happy ending, and I'm going to vote for number two.
Okay. David.
Well, Kitty, yet again.
Oh, goodness.
No, I am not going to vote for number two, because I thought number two hedged a little bit around her about her emotional reaction.
Uh-huh.
So I didn't get a chance to ask a question number three, so I'm going to stick with number one, who I did ask a question of.
Okay. Betty.
Well, because I'm psychic and I knew that the two people on my left were going to vote for number one and number two, I voted for number three.
Psychic powers.
Yes.
Orson.
Because my fellow panelists have used up all the intelligent answers, I voted for number two just for the hell of it. No, I think it is number two.
Okay. Well, the votes are all in, and number one, you have a single vote. Number two, you have a pair. And number three, you have a single vote. Now, for the moment of truth. Will the real Alma Sipple please stand up? Let's find out who our imposters are. Number one, your name and what do you do?
My name is Carol Krim, and I'm a school teacher for the LA Unified School District, and I work in Watts in a drug rehabilitation center.
Wonderful. Number three, your name and what do you do?
My name is Dorothy Smith, and I paint portraits of pets.
Well, you'll have to talk to Betty. She might have a few pets for you to paint. There were two incorrect answers, and at $500 a vote, your team will receive $1,000. Thank you very much for playing. Now, Alma, when did you finally meet Irma?
Last Thursday, a week ago.
Okay, now we have some tape. That was a very emotional event for you. And describe what you're feeling as we watch the video.
They're coming. Yeah. It was really wonderful. That's one of my daughters behind me. There, we're waiting for. There she is.
Irma, of course, could not be here. She's a nurse and she's working. But I imagine it's kind of, I don't know, a little good and a little bad because she's got this whole life. You still don't get a chance to see her very much, do you?
No, she's a head nurse in the operating room in the Jewish hospital in Cincinnati.
Well, I know you're very happy for her success.
Oh, yes.
And we'd like to thank all of you for being here today and playing on To Tell the Truth. We'll be back with a man who makes back-to-school clothes bulletproof right after this. We're back on To Tell the Truth. Let's meet our second group of challengers.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Stephen Dandrilli.
Number two.
My name is Stephen Dandrilli.
Number three.
My name is Stephen Dandrilli.
It's up to you, panel, to locate the real Stephen Dandrilli, and this is his story. Please read along with me. I, Stephen Dandrilli, make bulletproof clothes for kids. I'm an ex-cop and the head of a security firm. We have protected politicians, high-ranking businessmen, law enforcement officials, and now the unthinkable, body armor for children. Last summer, In less than a month, 8 children were killed by stray bullets in New York City. And who could forget the horrifying news footage of the California schoolyard massacre? Megan is wearing a jacket especially designed with bulletproof panels of Kevlar. New high-tech fibers allow us to create protective, lightweight, and fashionable fabrics. T-shirts, suits, and this hat that Willie is wearing can stop a 9mm bullet. No matter what the price, we must protect the children. Signed, Stephen Dandrilli. Orson, let's begin with you.
What an astonishing pass we've come to in this country. Number three, you planning to make any accessories like bulletproof lunch boxes or anything like that?
Actually, there are clipboards and knapsacks and a number of accessories now.
Number two, what's your potential market for this? Is it going to be middle-class yuppie parents? I mean, this is fairly expensive, I would imagine.
It will be upper-class and middle-class.
Yeah. Number one, have you ever tried to talk to school boards into hiring, having panels made for the school uniforms of those schools that have uniforms?
Well, it would be a wonderful thing. We could protect our children because they're the most important commodity we have.
And put a few bucks in your pocket, too, number one, right?
Yes, it would.
I'm not against that. That's the American way of life. Number two, tell me about yourself.
Time's up, Orson. Betty.
Number two, how do you explain to children what you're doing? How do you say you have to wear this? And how do you do that?
We tell them that they're very important to life and they're very precious, and to protect themselves with the gangs that are going on in the Los Angeles area and the different districts, that they need to protect themselves.
Number three, how do you convince your child to keep the garment on at all times?
Well, we sit down with the parents and the children. We explain the limitations of Kevlar, how important it is. Mommy and Daddy love you and would like you to wear this garment when you need it.
No, thank
David.
You.
David.
Thank you. Number one, how much did that pocket cost on that little girl?
That particular garment was around $450.
And number two, it's very expensive. That hat on the little boy?
$150, but depends on how wide you want to make the panel.
Well, I'm confused something about that hat. I mean, is it protected from the back or just from the front?
Just from the front, but you can arrange it to go from the front. It depends on how big you want the bulletproof panel.
Okay, number three, where are you based out of? Where do you, Los Angeles or New York? New York City. And number one...
City?
Well, I'd like to say that New York City gets a bum rap, and I don't think these things would help anybody anyway, because most of those children were shot either in their cribs or at home. This, number one, this has to be worn on the street. I don't see children being shot on the street on the way to school, do you?
I see it every day in the newspapers and on television, random drive-by shootings of drug dealers, innocent children getting hurt.
And number two, how can poor children afford this kind of expensive outerwear?
We reach out to the different grants that are available to us, that they may have the opportunity, even though they can't afford it, to receive money to buy these bullets.
Number three, do you have a pool of money to give to poor children?
No, actually what we're hoping for is corporate donations, similar to the way police departments receive donations, and we will match dollar for dollar any contributor so that the price of the Kevlar will be reduced significantly.
You. Number two, what is Kevlar made of?
Alan, that's it. The time is up. Time for you to vote for either number one, number two, or number three. And panel, if you're ready to vote, Orson, we'll start with you.
Yeah, well, I think sometimes we could use Kevlar panel things for the panelists here. I voted for number three. I believe this is a New York outfit, and he sounds like a New York guy. Looks like an entrepreneur. That means a guy who starts his own business. Thank you, David.
You're very welcome.
I thought that meant betweenpreneur. No, I didn't. Well, because he was able to go into the design, actually, and how far you put it around, I voted for number two.
David?
Well, I did not vote for number three because he name-dropped the Kevlar, and I figured that was a setup, and I thought that number two looked like he had probably tested the hat. And so that's why I voted for number two.
I think you're borrowing my hair theory over there. Is that what you're doing? Kitty?
Well, I voted for number one because he hotly defended his product as being essential when there are drive-bys and drug dealers are shooting children in the street.
Well, all the votes are in. Let's recap quickly. Number one, you have a single vote. Number two has two votes. Number three, you have a single vote. Now let's find out who the real child protector is, with the real Stephen Dandrilli. Please stand up. Number three. Stephen, let me ask you, how long did it take you to develop these products, or was it just a matter of pulling together different resources, different materials?
In New York City this summer, there were 8 children that were gunned down, caught between the crossfire of drug deals gone awry. And right before the school season, a number of concerned parents called upon us and met with us at our security offices. And together with these parents, we came up with the concept of protective clothing for their children. We've been manufacturing clothing and for, you know, executives and law enforcement. And what we did is just tone it down, and we made it available for the parents immediately so that they could have it for their children.
Well, it's good to see that this is an idea that at least the parents are behind and that they asked for it, and it's not strictly a commercial run here.
No, actually, okay. We're doing it as a public service.
Terrific. Let's find out who the imposters are. Number one, your name and what do you do?
My name is Tony Cannata, and I'm a ramp agent for an airline.
Terrific. Number two, your name and what do you do?
My name is Father Neil Kalayan. I'm a Roman Catholic priest, and I run a gang prevention program.
You're a Roman Catholic priest?
Yes, I am.
I never knew a priest with a haircut like that.
Well, it's better than carrying a gun and a bulletproof vest, really.
Okay. Listen, there are three... You're right about that. There are three incorrect votes. At $500 for each vote, you'll receive $1,500. Thank you very much for being here and playing on To Tell the Truth. We'll be right back to play one-on-one with someone in our studio audience right after this. It's now time to play one-on-one with someone from our studio audience. So, Burton, who do you have for us today?
Well, Lynn, today we have Helen Olagi from Covina, California.
Welcome, Helen.
Thank you.
Like that sweatshirt?
I like it, too.
Okay. Here's your chance to play one-on-one. I want you to meet a gentleman who has two stories. Please welcome Mike Pizzini. Now, Helen, Mike's going to tell you two stories, only one of which is the truth. If you spot that true story, you'll win $500. So, Mike, what's your first story?
Recently, I was sitting on my couch watching TV, and a plane landed in my living room.
Now, that may or may not be the truth, so listen to Mike's second story.
I won the World Pumpkin Contest. My pumpkin weighed 509 pounds.
Okay, panel, it's up to you to help Helen win $500. You'll ask one question about each story. Kitty, we'll start with the airplane story.
It's such a terrible story.
The question of your choice, Kitty.
Were you hurt?
No, I was fortunate. I was not hurt.
David.
What was your initial reaction?
My initial reaction, I thought we had an earthquake and sounded like an explosion. I thought maybe the water heater might explode it.
Betty.
What kind of a plane was it?
The crop dusting plane. It was crop dusting my artichoke farm.
Orson.
Did you keep watching the show, or did you...
No, I didn't watch the show. I jumped up, called 911, and I checked to see if I could help the pilot.
Okay, Helen, you've heard the first story. Now, story number two, the pumpkin.
How did you lift this enormous pumpkin without damaging it to get it on the truck?
I used... Quite a few of my neighbors came over to help me lift it up.
David.
What sort of fertilizer did you use to get it to grow the size?
I use Magic Grow.
Betty.
Did you do this on purpose? Is this the first? I mean, did it just get away from you, or have you joined? You have to answer yes or no. Have you grown pumpkins, big ones, before?
Yes, I have.
Orson?
Well, you got a big pumpkin, Mike. I got to congratulate you. My cousin in Vermont used to grow giant prunes. He used elephant fertilizer. It wasn't too popular with the neighbors. No, Mike, tell me about yourself. You look like an executive to me. How long have you been growing giant pumpkins?
About 4 years.
4 years, all right.
All right, Helen. I hope you can figure out something from all of that. You've heard that cross-examination. Was Mike the man who had the plane crash in his house, or did he grow a pumpkin that was 509 pounds?
He looks like, to me, he would be the man that was sitting and watching TV and having a plane crash in his house. I'd go with that.
Okay, Mike, what's your true story?
To tell the truth, I grew the world's largest pumpkin.
I'm sorry, Helen. You didn't win the money, but we do have a lovely gift for you. And Mike, you win $1,000 for stumping Helen. Congratulations. Now, we have a piece of tape. I mean, that pumpkin, 509 pounds, is too big for us to ship in here and show everyone. So we have a piece of tape of the weighing in this competition. Let's take a look at it. Now, how many people helped you pick that pumpkin up?
I had 8 of my neighbors and friends come over and help me pick it up.
You know. Now, I have a question for you. How many pumpkin pies can you make from a 509-pound pumpkin?
Well, I've been told you can make a pie a day for a whole year.
Okay, we're coming home with you for dessert. We'll be right back after these words. Thank you. We had a great time. We hope you enjoyed it. We'll see you next time on To Tell the Truth. So long.
Tonight on The Amazing Race, in picturesque Portugal, a detour turns dangerous. It's a mad dash to stay in the game.
There it is, straight down, straight down.
Run! You gotta do this now.
The Amazing Race, tonight at 10 on GSN.